Welcome to the lecture series on EC354 microprocessors. In the last lecture, we had gone through in detail regarding the 8085 block diagram and its internal architecture. In the same succession, while learning the 8085 in much more detail, in today's lecture, we will go through the 8085 pinout diagram, and we will proceed further with instruction cycle, machine cycle, and T states. Okay, so let us proceed further with 8085 pin diagram. Now, as 8085 is a 40 pin dual inline package chip, so we are going to start with pin number 1 over here. So it is a 40 pin dual inline, so 20 pins on this side and 21 to 40 on this side. Okay, so let me write down all the pin numbers first. Okay, so we are having 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 10, 11, 12, 19 and 20. All these pins are there. In the same way, we are supposed to proceed further with, this is the 21st, then we are having 22, 23, 25, 26, 27, 28, 29, 30. In the same way, 31 to 40. So all these pins are there, so that is the 8085 microprocessor pin diagram. As I told you that it is a dual inline package, okay, so we are having 20 pins on this side and 20 on the other side. That is the DIC package, the IC package that we have for 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so recall back the internal architecture that we had studied for the 8085 microprocessor, and in that we had gone through the data bus and the address bus, and we know that the lower order address and data bus of the 8085 microprocessor is a multiplexed one. Okay, so let us start with the address bus. So address bus starts from pin number 21. That is, the pin number 21 is A8 and pin number 28 is A15. So we are having the address bus, that is A8, A9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14 and 15. So we are having A8 to A15. That is the higher order address bus, that is from pin number 21 to 28. So total 16 address lines we have in 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so out of that, the higher order address bus, that is A8 to A15, is on 21 to 28. The low order address and data bus is a multiplexed one, so we are having AD address and data, we will write, that is AD0 to AD7 we will write. Okay, that is from pin number 19 to pin number 12. So pin number 12 is our AD0, so we are having AD0, then we are having AD1, then we are having AD2, AD3, AD4, AD5, AD6, and 87. So we are having the address and data bus for the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, that is from pin number 12. Pin number 20, which is left, okay, that is VSS or the ground pin for the 8085 microprocessor, and pin number 40 is the VCC or the supply voltage, the positive supply voltage that we will give, that is the plus 5 volt and ground to this chip is pin number 40 and pin number 20. Okay. So we do have the address bus from pin number 12 to 19 and 21 to 28, a whole 16-bit address bus, as well as a data bus that is from pin number 12 to pin number 19. So as while discussing the block diagram, we have gone through that this address and data bus are multiplexed. Okay, so when we are supposed to use a data bus, then this bus is to be demultiplexed. So to demultiplex this lower order address and data bus, there is a signal on pin number 30. The name of the signal is ALE, that is the address latch enable signal. As the name suggests, it is address latch enable signal. So during the first clock cycle, later on when we go through the timing diagram, we will come up with the concept of T states. So while going through the T states, we will find that there are individual timings which are being given to the instruction. Okay, so in that we will find that there are T states. So the first clock cycle is the first T state. So during the first clock cycle, when the instruction execution is started, basically address latch enable is activated, means this signal will goes from low to a high signal is being given. Okay, so because of this, what will happen, the address will latch on the address bus. The high order address bus is a pure address bus, so there is a high byte will be there in the high order address bus. In low order address bus, now the address is latched whenever the ALE signal is active. Okay, so keep in mind ALE is your address latch enable pin. So whenever the address latch enable pin is active, the address will be latched on 80 to 87. So it will work as A0 to A7. That is the ALE. And after the first clock cycle, it is being deactivated. So later on, this can be used as data bus. Okay. So that is the ALE. Then to show the status of this data bus, there are two status pins, that is S0 on pin number 29 and pin number 33 is S1. There are two data bus status pins, okay, which will show the status of the data bus. Okay, so depending on the value of S0 and S1, it will show the status of the data bus. Okay, so for data bus status, if we take the value of S0 and S1, if we take the value 00, then the data bus is in the halt status. Okay, it is in the halt status, means it is doing nothing, means it is stop execution, that is halt. Okay, if it is 01, that is S1 and S0, we are supposed to write it this way. If S0 is 1 and S1 is 0, then it is performing the write operation. If it is 10, then it is performing a read operation. If it is 11, then it is performing a fetch operation. As I already gone through the concept of the working of the microprocessor, so in the working of the microprocessor, we came to know that that basically microprocessor will fetch the opcode from the memory and then it is being executed by the microprocessor. So basically these three words we had learned earlier in the lecture series, that is fetch, decode and execute. Okay. So it will perform a fetch operation, means the opcode fetch operation. Then we are having this read write and the stop execution, that is NOT. Okay. So S0 and S1 shows the status of the data bus, that what exactly the data bus is doing at present. Okay. So that depends on the status pins S0 and S1. Okay. Now see that the pin number 31 and 32, they are read and write pins. Okay, these two signals are there, read and write, that the microprocessor is performing a read operation or a write operation. Okay, that depends on the active signal on the pin number 31 and 32, that is the read signal and the write signal. Okay, so these two signals are there for the read and write operation. Now this read write, it is performing with memory or IO. So pin number 34 is IO or memory. If a logic 0 is being given to pin number 34, then it is doing a read write or fetch from memory, and if a logic 1 is given on this pin, then it is communicating with the IO device. Okay, so all these control signals are being used for IO device, like read, write and all that. Okay, so IO and memory is the pin by which the microprocessor decides that it is communicating with a memory or a IO device. Okay, so after IO and memory, let us proceed further with the next signals to provide the clocking to the microprocessor. We are having these two pins on pin number 1 and 2. Pin number 1 and 2 is X1, X2, that is crystal 1, crystal 2 pins. Okay. So a RC circuit or a quartz crystal can be connected to this X1 and X2, that is crystal 1 and crystal 2. Okay. Basically, the internal oscillator is set in a way that whatever the frequency we input to this pin number 1 and 2 via quartz crystal, that frequency is to be divided by 2. So practically, if we apply 6.14 megahertz of crystal to X1 and X2, then the half of that is 3.07 megahertz will become the working frequency of 8085 microprocessor. So that will become its working frequency. Okay, so that will provide the clock synchronization to the microprocessor. Okay, so the crystal will be connected on X1, X2. Okay, now see that on pin number 37, we are having a clock out also. So whatever the input clock which is being received, okay, the double of that frequency is being outputted from the clock out signal. So the double of that is being outputted from the clock out signal. Okay, so if we are inputting 6.14 megahertz, then the double of that we will get from the clock out. Okay, then the next signals that we are supposed to go through is pin number 35. Pin number 35 is a ready signal. Okay, so while microprocessor is performing read and write operation from memory or IO device, what exactly is going on is that if it is performing for an example, a read operation from memory, and at the same time some other service is being required from the microprocessor, and if it is unable to detect the service, then in those cases there is a facility in 8085, like a ready pin is there which will check the microprocessor for readiness, that it is ready to perform the read or write operation or not, or it is doing something else. So that can be checked using the ready pin. Okay, so if ready pin is at logic 1, means it is ready to accept the instructions to perform the task. Okay, and if ready pin is active low, means if a logic 0 is there in the ready pin, means microprocessor is doing something. Okay, that can be checked using the status pins, that is S0 and S1. Okay, so we will wait for the ready pin, and depending on the status of the ready pin, we can give the instructions to the microprocessor to read or write from IO or memory. Okay, so that is the pin number 35, that is the ready pin. Now, to reset the whole system, the pin number 36 is the reset in signal. It is active low signal, that's why a bar is there. Okay, so keep in mind, wherever you see a signal with a bar, that means it is an active low signal. So reset in is an active low signal, and it will reset the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so the program counter value will become 00. So the very first location from where the program execution start is the 0th memory location. Okay, so it will reset the CPU. Okay, by giving a reset also on the pin number 36 of 8085 microprocessor. It is having a reset out also on pin number 3. It is having reset out also on pin number 3 for other devices which are being connected to 8085 microprocessor. So the same pulse can be given to other devices to reset. Okay, after that, let us see the two pins, that is pin number 38 and 39. They are hold and the acknowledgement for that is hold acknowledge, that is hold and hold acknowledge pins, that is pin number 38 and 39. This is being used for DMA, that is for direct memory access. See, many times for faster communication between the memories, the involvement of the microprocessor is not required. Okay, so in those cases, a direct memory access is performed by an external memory. Okay, so in that case, this hold signal is being given to the microprocessor. So microprocessor recognizes the hold signal, and it will relinquish the use of system buses in the next clock cycle, or it will complete the last instruction which it is performing, and it will release the system buses for the other external master to use the system buses. Okay, so the microprocessor relinquishes the use of the system buses. Okay, while the hold signal is being given by an external master, so the external master will use the system buses of the 8085 microprocessor to communicate with the memory which is being connected to the microprocessor. So there is a direct communication which is being established by using the internal system bus of the microprocessor. As soon as the work is being done, and hold acknowledge signal is being given, and the microprocessor again gets the system buses and again start using the system buses. Okay, so that is the hold and hold acknowledge pin for direct memory access. Okay, so for direct memory access, we are having hold and hold acknowledge pin. Later on, when we go for the DMA controller in detail. Okay, we will again go through these two pins, that is hold and hold eye punch. After then, the pin number 4 and 5, that is serial output data and serial input data. Okay, so these two pins are for serial communication. So we can have a serial input data on SID pin and serial output data on SOD pin. Okay, so these two pins are being used when we go for the RIM and SIM instruction. So later on when we learn RIM and SIM instructions in detail, okay, we will go through the serial output data and serial input data in detail. Okay, so just keep in mind that this is for serial communication. So serial port is there using serial input data and serial output data. Okay, for serial input data RIM instruction is there, and for serial output data SIM instruction is there. Okay, and lastly we are having the interrupt pins. So pin number 6 we are having, that is the trap. Okay, so all these pins are being dedicated to the interrupts that we have seen during the block diagram. So we are having trap, RST 7.5, RST 6.5, RST 5.5, and finally the pin number 10, that is INTR, that is interrupt request. And for interrupt request we are having interrupt acknowledge, okay. So total 5 interrupts we have in 8085 microprocessor, that is pin number 6 to pin number 10. Okay, that is trap is a non-maskable interrupt, others are maskable. Okay, we are having trap, restart interrupts, interrupt request, and for interrupt request we are having interrupt acknowledge. Okay, among this your restart interrupts and trap is a vectored interrupt, INTR is a non-vectored interrupt. So after INTR a restart or a call instruction is being required, okay, to go through the interrupt service routine. Okay, so these are the 5 interrupt pins. And for INTR, we are having interrupt acknowledge also. Okay, so this is a user definable interrupt present in 8085 microprocessor, that is interrupt request, and other is already being defined by the microprocessor, that is trap and the restart interrupts. The priorities are like this: highest priority is the trap, lowest priority is the INTR. Among restart interrupts only, RST 7.5 is having the highest priority and RST 5.5 is having the lowest priority. Okay, so that is all about the 8085 pinout diagram. Okay, so total 40 pins we had gone through in detail. Okay, so in later discussion we will use this pins and we will see the use of these pins in more detail while we go through the peripheral interface or the other interfaces with the 8085 microprocessor. We are going to use these pins. That's why we are going through the pinout diagram in detail. Okay. So after going through the pinout diagram, let us proceed further with the instruction cycle. So let us proceed further with the instruction cycle. Now see that to perform a task, some instructions are being given to the microprocessor in form of binary patterns. Now, that instructions or group of instructions is also known as a program, which is being written for a microprocessor, so the microprocessor can perform a specific task. Okay, so instruction cycle is nothing but the total time that is being taken by the microprocessor to perform a specific task. So basically, the instruction cycle is comprising of two things. Okay, so as we had seen that, we can write instruction cycle is equal to fetch cycle plus execution cycle. Okay, so initially, for a microprocessor to perform a task, what actually it will do is that the first operation which is being involved is the fetch operation. Means the instructions or the binary patterns, or you can say the machine codes, are stored in the memory. So how exactly the microprocessor is going to execute the program? So all the machine code is being written into the memory, and the execution will be sequential. Means it will take the first instruction from the memory, execute it, then it will take the next one, then next one in there. Okay, means the first operation which is being performed by the microprocessor to execute a program is the fetch cycle, is the fetch operation. Means it fetches the instruction opcode from the memory. So every instruction is having two fields, that is opcode and operand. In many cases, if the operands are inside the microprocessor, then in most of the cases they are one byte instructions. So for one byte instructions, these two things, a fetch cycle and execution cycle, they will be done within the same fetch cycle. Okay, so this fetch cycle, every instruction is having opcode. So this fetch cycle is constant, and it is for every instruction. Okay, so every instruction is having a fixed fetch cycle, and depending on the operands, it is having a variable execution cycle. So for one byte instruction, there is only one cycle, that is the fetch cycle. For two byte instructions, depending on the operands, it may have 1, 2, or depending on the functionality of the instruction, the different execution cycles. Okay, for an example, if we take a simple one byte instruction like no operation, which is doing nothing, no operation, okay, and its machine code is 00H. So what the microprocessor will do, it will fetch 00H from the memory, and it will put it into the data register. From data register it will go to the instruction register, and from that it will decode it, and it find that it is doing nothing. So it is having only one instruction cycle, that is the fetch cycle only. Okay, so instruction cycle for the no op instruction is only fetch cycle. But if we go for some other instruction like MVI A, 12H, okay, now that is a 2 byte instruction. MVI hex code is 3, and if we hand assemble it, in the operand field there is an immediate data, that is 12H. Okay, so it is a 2 byte instruction which is having 2 bytes. Okay, as a machine code, the first one is the opcode, and the next one is the 8 bit immediate data present in the operand field of the instruction. So while that 3E travels from memory to the microprocessor, it will go to the instruction register, and when that 3 is being decoded, microprocessor comes to know that there is a data present in the memory. So the next operation is the read operation. So from the memory that data is being read, and that is being put into the accumulator. Okay, so the next cycle, the execution cycle, may comprising of a read operation. Okay, so fetch cycle is fixed. So this one is fixed for every instruction. Fixed for every instruction. This is variable. Depends on the instruction. Okay, and this can be a memory read cycle. This can be a memory write cycle. This can be a IO read cycle or IO write cycle or combination of this. Okay, so basically the execution cycle can be memory read, memory write, IO read and IO write. Okay, so the whole instruction cycle comprising of a fetch cycle and an execution cycle. So fetch cycle is fixed for every instruction and execution cycle is variable. For one byte instruction there is no need, inside the fetch cycle it is there. Okay, so in the last clock cycle of the fetch cycle it is, the instruction is being executed, and depending on the instruction it can be a memory read cycle, memory write cycle, IO read cycle and IO write cycle, that we will see later on in the next lecture when we go for the timing diagram. Okay, so our instruction cycle is equal to fetch cycle plus execution cycle. Okay, so that is the instruction cycle. Let us proceed further with the fetch cycle or the fetch operation. Let us proceed further with the fetch operation. Execute operation. Now see that what exactly going inside the microprocessor while it fetches the opcode. So opcode is present in the memory. So the microprocessor fetches the opcode from the memory. So to fetch a opcode from the memory, the 16-bit address from where the opcode is present in the memory, that memory location address will be put into the address bus. So initially program counter is having that address, so that is being put into the address bus. Okay, and from that address the opcode is being put into the data bus. That will go to the data bus buffer in 8085 microprocessor. From there it will go to the instruction register and then it is decoded, and dependingly it will have the execute cycle. Okay, the execution is being performed. After decoding the instruction, it will find that is all the operands are present inside the microprocessor, or it is in memory, or from an IO it is supposed to receive. Okay, so it may have that variable execution cycle in case of a memory read is required, or a memory write is required, or IO read or IO write is required. Okay, so dependingly we are having this variable execution cycle. Okay, so in execute operation that thing is being performed. Okay, so we are having this fetch operation and the execute operation. In most of the cases the fetch operation is comprising of three clock cycles and execute operation also for every operation or every cycle. It is of three clock cycles. But if a microprocessor is interfaced with slower memory, then it is necessary to give some time to the microprocessor so it can fetch the opcode from the memory and put it into the memory or the data register present inside the microprocessor, or for the execution it will take some time. Okay, so in most of the cases the fetch operation comprising of four clock cycles including one wait state. Okay, so that wait state will provide some more time for data to reach to the microprocessor, and after that it will be decoded and executed by the microprocessor. Okay, so basically if we see the instruction cycle in form of a clock pulses. In form of a clock pulses, if we see the instruction cycle, if this is the first clock pulse, okay, it is starting from here, then a second one, then a third one, okay. So basically, ideally, this will be the fed cycle. Ideally, they are three only till this point, okay. We are having the clock signals, and after this, we are having this variable execution cycle. So typically, it is comprising of, let us say, it is comprising of these three clock cycles. Okay, so this will be the execution cycle, and this whole will be the instruction cycle. So instruction cycle is comprising of fetch cycle and execution cycle. Okay, so these individual clock cycles, okay, they are being known as T states. So they are being given name. These are known as T states. So they are being given name as T1, T2, T3 for fed cycle, and in the same way T1, T2, T3 for execute cycle. Okay. So this is the typical diagram for a 2-byte instruction. Okay. So the first byte is always opcode fetch. That is the fetch cycle, and the second byte that is present in memory or IO. Okay, so it can be an execute cycle. Is it clear? Okay, so that is a typical example for a 2-byte instruction, okay, which is having a fetch cycle and an execute cycle separate. Okay, so after going through this, let us proceed further with the machine cycle and state. Let us proceed further with the machine cycle and T states. Okay. So the necessary steps to carry out an operation is basically called a machine cycle. Okay, so basically, to execute an instruction, there are different steps. Okay, so like we are having a opcode fetch operation, we are having memory write operation. Okay, so let me list. We are having this opcode fetch, memory write, memory read, IO write, IO read. Okay. So these are being known as the machine cycle individually. Okay, so you can write it as machine cycle 1 for opcode fetch, machine cycle 2, depending on the instruction that we can have. Okay, so we are having opcode fetch and the execution cycle in form of this. Okay, is it clear? And the individual T state, the individual clock cycle inside this opcode fetch and the other execution cycle is known as T states, that I had shown to you in the previous diagram. Okay, so that is being given the name T1, T2, T3, and depending on that timing we can explain the working. Okay, so for a particularly opcode fetch, okay, so the instruction cycle we can write, that can be in form of M1 plus M2 in that way. We can write, okay, M1 is always opcode fetch, and this will depend on the execution cycle. Okay, so So instruction cycle can be written in form of machine cycles also. Okay, so it can be M1, that is opcode fetch plus in that. Okay, and opcode fetch will have 4 T states. Keep in mind, opcode fetch is always going to have 4 T states. Okay, so that is the machine cycle and the T states. After that, let us go through the instruction and data flow inside the 8085 microprocessor. Let us proceed further with the instruction and data flow inside the microprocessor. Then how exactly the instruction and data flows inside the microprocessor? For that, you need to again recall back the block diagram for the better understanding. Okay, so basically the opcode which is there inside or the stored in the memory, okay, so initially that address is there in program counter, from where the opcode is to be fetched, that address is there in the program counter. Okay, so that address is being put into memory address register. Okay, in 8085 we are having the address buffers or the memory address buffers we are having. Okay, so the program counter value is being put into memory address register, and that is being given to the memory address bus, that is being given to the memory address bus. Okay, so the program counter value will be given to the memory address register, that is being given to the memory address bus. So it will point to that memory location where the opcode is there. Okay, so that opcode is being given to the memory data bus, that is being loaded into the data bus. Okay, and that is being given to the memory data register, that is the data buffer inside the 8085 microprocessor. That is being given to the instruction register. So instruction register is going to store the opcode which is being currently executed by the microprocessor. Okay, then it is being given to the instruction decoder. So we are having instruction decoder, so that will decode and execute the instruction. And we are having the control unit which will increment the program counter by 1. So now the program counter points to the next memory location from where the data is to be fetched from the memory. Okay, so this is how the instruction flow is there. This is how the instruction will flow inside the microprocessor. Okay, to know the data flow, we will use the block diagram that we had gone through in the last lecture. Okay, so as we had seen in this, the data that is present in the memory, that data is to travel inside the microprocessor using the data bus. So this is the data bus, 8-bit data bus is there. Okay, so initially the data in the memory is being put into the data register. It is a bidirectional, that is a data bus to or from memory. Okay, so from memory the data can be taken or can be stored. Okay, so it will go to the data register first, and then that is being communicated to the internal 8-bit data bus, and from that 8-bit data bus it can travel to the general purpose registers that we have, general purpose registers. Okay, so in 8085 microprocessor we are having, that is your BCDHL registers. Okay, so that data can go into the general purpose registers. Okay, or it can travel to the accumulator register. Okay, that can be used with arithmetic logic unit or connected with arithmetic logic unit, that is again given back to the accumulator after processing, or it can be given to a temporary register and from temporary register to accumulator. Okay, so the data from the memory, the data flow inside the microprocessor, that data will travel from memory or it can go other way also. Okay, so the data present in the memory, if we take, that will go to the data register, and from data register using the 8-bit data bus, depending on the instruction which is being decoded, as we are seeing in the instruction flow diagram, that will go to the particular destination depending on the instruction. Okay, so if we are having MVI A,12H, okay, so that 12H data will go to the data register and then it will go to the accumulator register. Is it clear? So that is how the data will flow inside the 8085 microprocessor. Okay, so that's all we have for today's lecture. In the next lecture, we will start the timing diagram. Okay, thank you very much for watching.